Our Ancestors in Italy is a book that shows what it was like at the beginning of the 20th century in Italy, through postcards that were sent out at that period of time, through their images and many times what was written on the front or back of them. Here are just a few of the many images contained in this book. They bring you into a world that no longer exists. $100,000 on the lighthouses, $10 million on the port of Reggio, $4 million on the port of San Giovanni, about 2,000 vessels, large and small, were destroyed at Messina, 1,000 at Reggio, 300 at Catania, 200 at San Giovanni, and 400 at Riposte. Before the earthquake, a brilliant aurora borealis was seen on the Italian side, accompanied by dull subterranean rumblings. Then the sea. Rome, January 31st, 1915. Dear little one, thank you for your long letter, to which I am responding with a little more calmness. We are now working a lot with the survivors of the earthquake. If only the weather would clear up. It has rained so much and the ruins are under snow. The survivors have to struggle with the cold and the wolves. The roads are impassable, but Rome has shown itself worthy of its name and is tireless in its charity. All respond to our appeals. Affectionate kisses from Eugenia and from your Louisa. During the eruption of Vesuvius in 1906, at the village of San Giuseppe, 60 people were badly injured when the roof fell in at Mass. After the roof caved in, only a statue of St. Anne was miraculously unharmed. The statue was taken to Bosco Reale, to the east to confront the lava, and was frequently moved backwards as the tide of lava continued to advance. The woman, weeping with fright, implored a miracle to stay the advance. The wedding scene in the town of Scano, in the Abruzzi region of Italy. They wore a unique headdress to go along with their ankle-length pleated skirts and homespun wool, with dark black bodices. The different thing about their wedding was that instead of inviting people to be in their wedding party, the party consisted of all the newlyweds who had married in Scano that year. This image shows the portrait of an old woman and a piece of lace. Her name was Cencia Scarpariola. She gained notoriety in 1872 at Burano in the Lagoon of Venice. That winter had been so severe that the port was icebound and the fishing fleet could not get out to sea. People were starving. Then someone remembered that Cencia was the only one left that remembered the old stitch that had made Venice renowned at one time. She taught other women and children the stitch, and with that income, the island was saved from starvation. A scene in the shop at Fabriano shows a Catholic cooperative that made priest hats. There is an interesting message on the back of the card to a customer who owes them 23.55 lire from the preceding year and promises legal action if he doesn't pay up. It's signed by the president of the company. There were many goat milk sellers at this time in Italy or Capri. The nanny goats, thousands of them, would troop into town morning and night and then are driven out to pasture again on the hills on the edge of town. In the different neighborhoods, the herd breaks up and goes its own rounds. One goat alone will go up the stairs of a building with the goat herder to be milked. Goats have a lot of character. They will not get out of the way of a bicycle, but are far too smart to be run over by a carriage. When His Excellency Zanardelli, pictured in the center of the cart, traveled especially to see the conditions in the south, apparently the first prime minister who thought this half of Italy worth a visit. He was surprised and shocked when the mayor of Moliterno in Basilicata greeted him on behalf of the 8,000 people in town, 3,000 of whom are in America, and the other 5,000 preparing to follow them.